The important people here, is that what you said?
Well.
Oh, Miss Julia, I just saw your arm. That's your sweetheart. Well, good morning. I'm glad you are here to worship God. I'm glad we're able to gather together today. And I'm glad that we're all in the house of God. Any announcements that I need to know about? I had put some announcements in a slideshow so that they could sort of show in rotation before worship started, and now that file is nowhere to be found on my computer. So our typical, remember your masks, remember your distancing, let me know if you turn up positive. We've had two more positive results in the church this week, unvaccinated, but yet now positive. They're home, they're fine. I don't believe they were here last Sunday, so we should be fine. But also, check in the inside of your bulletin there. Take that home with you. Stick it on your fridge about our announcements, particularly our church-wide rummage sale next weekend in the Family Life Center / outside. We're going to try to have it outside as much as possible for safety reasons. And I want you to think about what you have that you can pull out of a closet or an attic or wherever, and be sure and bring those up so we can raise as much money as possible for the community. And please let Melissa know if you can volunteer in any sort of way. Confirmation class, nursery manager, all of that stuff. Justin and I will be out of town next weekend, and Jeremy will help me. Do you know him? Anyone? He's the chaplain out of U of O, and he's going to come and bring a word next week. Since we're about to start our Bible study, I've asked him to come and speak about his own relationship with the Bible, his own life transformation because of the Bible, and so hopefully he's going to share that message with you. Any other announcements? Okay. Well, I'm glad you are here. Let us prepare our hearts for worship as the light of Christ enters the sanctuary. Let's pray. Lord God, let our souls be joined as we sing Alleluia to you. As we sing your praises, as we sing of your goodness, your mercy, your love, your steadfastness in our lives, as we sing your praises together, Lord, as your people this morning, draw near to us, hold us, love us, change us, challenge us. These things we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. And now would you stand for our call to worship? Come into the Lord's house with singing and praise. Come into his presence. Help us, Lord, to hear your truths and walk in your light. We want to share your love and goodness, Lord. Alleluia. Amen. Amen. remain standing for our affirmation of faith, a modern affirmation. Oh, our opening hymn. Yeah, sorry. Let's sing our opening hymn together. I love divine, I love success.
Thank you.
know. And when we give, it is a sign of our worship of you. It is a sign of our commitment to the work of the church. And it is a sign of our love for one another and for our community and this world you have placed us in. Lord God, bless our giving. Bless those who give. We ask these things in the name of Christ. Side of the altar. altar rail, and one on the altar. I have five here today. If you want one of those and you're not somebody who can easily order online, or you've never ordered online, or you're skeptical of ordering online, and you would like one of those, feel free to come up and get it after the service. I would say if you want to just leave a love offering for it, whatever, it's fine. Romanda told me she was able to find a used copy online this week for like $6 and some change, and so that's wonderful. Rhonda has ordered, I think she had to get 13 copies to get the free shipping or something like that. So we should have some more coming in this week to the church office. Again, if you want to pick one up at the church office. And speaking of the story, I want to start this morning's message by asking simply, and somebody just shout out a number, if you were to guess how many Bibles you have in your house, whatever translation they may be, wherever you got them, however old they are, how many do you think you have in your house? You think you have four, two, four, five, ten? Yeah, probably most of us have multiple copies of the Bible in a variety of translations. I brought some of mine today. This one, though it is beautiful on the outside, I don't really particularly like this version of the Bible. It's the Common English Bible translation, which is not my favorite translation. But I keep this one on my desk at the office because, well, it's pretty. But also because it's a quick reference. And then I have this one. And this is just a few of the many we have at our house. This one my dad bought for me. I may have shown it to y'all before, but I bet from where you're sitting, you can't even see those words. Because holding it, I can barely see them. Even with my trifocals, it's so tiny. I love this Bible. I keep hold of it because my daddy bought it for me while I was in seminary. But I don't use it because I can't read it. It's too small. Also, this one, I don't know if any of you recognize this one. I know Mr. John has one of these. This is a Wesley Bible. All the footnotes and lots of extra notes in there come from Wesley's sermons and a lot of Wesley's writings. This is one of two copies I have of this one. This one has my name on it. It's the prettier, more intact of the two, so I don't use it much because I want it to stay pretty. It was given to me by one of my DSs. This one, the Inspirational Study Bible. General Editor Max Lucado. It's a good book. I call it, though, my file cabinet Bible. Because as I was in seminary, I was attending St. Luke United Methodist Church most of the time, and when Pastor Gordon would preach, they had these long bulletins, and they were like quadruple fold. And I would write notes about his sermons real tiny as he was preaching, and then I would file it, like if this one came out of 2 Luke, I would stick it in 2 Luke. And so this one I call my file cabinet Bible. I don't use it for study much, but it's my file cabinet. We also have women's Bibles at our house and men's Bibles and recovery Bibles. We have all sorts of Bibles at our house. This one is like my third or fourth copy of this particular one, the New Interpreter Study Bible. It's NRSV. It's my favorite. There's lots of scholarly footnotes, study notes. I have, from my Old Testament class and my New Testament class, tiny notations. Instead of typing my notes, I wrote them in my Bible as they were preaching and teaching in class. This is about my, like I said, third or fourth copy of this one. Love this Bible. It's a very, very good one for study. This one, in fact, that I have all these notes from seminary, and is in my list of things people will inherit. And our oldest niece, Taylor, will inherit this. I also have one of these great big ones that I didn't bring today. Have you seen one of these? The family Bibles they often give you after a funeral? Completely impractical, right? Nobody would ever carry that around. But it has great pictures in it and timelines and charts and all sorts of things. So I like that one for those reasons. And then I have the story. Now this one doesn't look like those because I don't like the covers. So I took the cover off. But this is the Story Bible, and this is what we are about to embark on a journey together to study. Now, I had never heard of the Story Bible until I got to Mountain Home, where I served there for 4 years, but we did a church-wide study of the story there, and I think we started in September and went through April, if I remember correctly. It's easy to read. There are 31 chapters. They're about 10 pages in length each, so it's can consume it and digest it easily. Our whole church at Mount Hope studied it together at the same time, from the Sunday schools all the way from the little ones to the older ones. We had small groups that did it in the evenings. We covered it every week in sermon, in worship, and it was a great, great study from Genesis to Revelation, talking about God's love story for God's people and God's creation. And that's where I got the idea for us to do this Bible study together here at this church. One, because I would love to go through it again myself, and two, because I think it will be good for us. Because as a people of the Word, it is important that we study the Word. Y'all say that with me. As a people of the Word, it's important that we study the Word. Super important. I read a quote online this week that I love, love, love. Whatever story we let sink into our souls will navigate our lives. Or stories, right? Whatever stories we let sink into our souls will navigate our lives. And I don't know about you, but I want God's story to be the story, first and foremost, that sinks into my soul, your soul, and the soul of our church, so that it might navigate our lives. I want the story of God's love to sink into our souls so that we become more loving as God is loving. I want the story of God's forgiveness to sink into our souls so that we become more able and likely to be a forgiving people. I want the story of God's wisdom to sink into our souls so that we have the wisdom of God within us to navigate our lives. And I want the story of God's transforming grace and power and hope to sink into our souls so that we can be a church and a people who help transform God's world with Him and give redeeming hope. When God's story sinks into our souls, it has the power to change everything about who we are and how we live and how we conduct ourselves in the world, how we see the world, how we see other people. When we study God's Word, it has the power to change everything about our lives. My life, maybe some of your lives too, are a true testament. Because it was only through intense Bible study over a 3-4 year period at Bryant Methodist before I became a pastor that my life was so changed that I'm able to be here in this space today. Maybe that sort of same sort of thing has happened to you by the power of the Bible. Deuteronomy 11:18 says, "You shall therefore lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul." It's critically important as the people of God that we lay up His word in our heart and our soul. And the rest of that verse says that we should bind them as a sign on our head and place the words of God between our eyes. So in the Hebrew scriptures, it's talking about this vitally important thing for us to put the scriptures where we can see them, where they're between our eyes and on our hands. We see our hands all day, every day. Right? And the Hebrew scriptures tell us, bind them on your hands and put them between your eyes. Keep God's word ever before you and always near to you so that you always have it there to help you navigate and live an abundant life. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and for instruction in righteousness." And me, I want all of that. I want doctrine, I want reproof, correction, and I certainly want instruction in righteousness. How to live the life God has called me to live, you to live, and us as a church to live. This is invaluable. The scriptures are invaluable for this. The more literal translation of this is that all scripture is God-breathed. And we know from Genesis that God's breath gives life. So if we want life in us and life to emit from us, we have to study God's word. The psalmist says, "Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for our path." Without God's word, we stumble and stumble and stumble. We fall a lot. But with God's word navigating our lives, showing us the path, illuminating our path, we're more likely to walk upright, to walk in the will of God. Matthew 7:25 says, "Everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock." When we allow God's word to be our lamp and our light, it gives us this solid foundation on which to trot and to build our lives. God's word changes our hearts, illuminates our paths, and guides our steps. So I cannot wait for us to embark on this journey together. And I want to take just a minute to tell you kind of what's ahead of us in this journey together. For one, I'd like everybody to get a copy. Has anybody got one yet? Gotten one yet? Good. All right. I'd like everybody to get a copy of the story. And what I learned this week, I thought they were all NIV, New International Version, but Rhonda said, well, she was searching online, some of them are the New King James Version. So if you prefer that, that's okay too. We're going to use the NIV. I think it's more easily read. So my vision for us is that we would all of us get a copy, per household or per person. And that we would read a chapter together each week in our own time. Read it all at once, read it in several sittings, however you want to do it. And that before you get to church on Sunday, we will have all read chapter 1 or chapter 2 or whatever chapter we're on. And then I would like to invite you to come to Sunday school. There's a room just up the stairs, an area, I should say, where we're going to have a TV set up and some chairs set up. And if you haven't been in Sunday school for a while, I invite you to come. Or if you've gotten out of the habit of being in Sunday school, or if you've been in Sunday school, I'd like you to come and all of us gather together and watch the video together and then break into our small groups and discuss what we've heard. The video is really good. You're going to learn some stuff about the Bible that you have not heard before. Be challenged in new ways and have your mind about the Bible enlightened in many ways. So I'd like everybody to have a Bible, a story Bible by the 3rd. That's where we're going to kick all this off. But technically, you don't have to have it until the 10th. Because the 3rd, I'm going to do a sermon that sort of talks about how the story is set up and how we're going to study it together. And then on the 10th is when we're going to start with chapter 1. So we'll need our books, and we'll need to have read chapter 1 by the 10th. And I'd like to invite you, like I said, to be a part of Sunday school. And it's going to be awesome. And it couldn't help but be awesome because we're going to be studying God's Word together, right? We're going to explore stories of the greats of the Bible, from Jacob to Esther to Naomi and Ruth to Mary to Joseph, Judas, Hannah and Samuel, Abraham and Sarah, the disciples and Moses, you name it. We're going to study and talk about their stories. We're going to dive into the major themes of the scripture, like covenant making and keeping, forgiveness, mercy, second chances, steadfast love, obedience, faithfulness, the brokenness of humanity and how badly we need God's redemptive grace. The redemptive power of God. We're going to talk about things such as the building of God's kingdom on earth, the spread of the gospel message, the following of footsteps, in the footsteps of Christ, walking in faith and being moved individually and collectively by God's Holy Spirit. And it's going to be awesome. Like I mentioned last week, it is a narrative Bible. It's going to be easy for you to read. We're going to do this 10-7, so October 7th through May 29th. And in the course of those weeks of studying the Bible together, I feel like probably somebody's going to be reminded of a story in the Bible they've forgotten about, hadn't read in a while. We're going to be reminded of a character we haven't encountered in a while. And hopefully we're going to learn some lessons from those stories that we haven't heard or contemplated in a while, if not ever. And I want each week, I want us to ask ourselves the question, how does this part of God's story that I have read this week impact my daily life now, today? My job, my family, my personal spiritual journey. How is what I'm reading this week impacting my daily life now? And here's why I want us to do this study together. One, because as we said at the beginning, it's important that the people of God study God's word. It's also important that we study the God's word because, as I said earlier, it is life-changing when we study it. I think I want to also do this together because we've had so much time apart. This will be something great to do together to strengthen us and to walk in faith together. And because we need his story to penetrate our souls and therefore to navigate our lives. But I also want to say that I want us to do this together because we cannot afford to be biblically illiterate. Partially biblically literate, right? Dustin was visiting with a friend of his that he works with this past week or 2 weeks ago. As a kid, he was a few years younger than me. We grew up together in high school. I don't know him that well, and I certainly don't know him that well as an works with him week in and week out. And this guy is broken. He is super, super lost. Drugs and alcoholism, going through a separation in his marriage, the guy is lost. And they had a chance to sit down one evening a week or two ago, and this guy begins asking Dustin things because he knows he's a pastor's husband and he knows he's a man of God and all these things. And so he's asking Dustin questions about the Bible and saying to him, you know, I haven't been in church probably 5 times in my whole life. This is not a family that grew up bringing our children to church. And even as an adult, he's scarcely gone the doors of the church. And he's wants, he says to Dustin, to read the Bible, but he's unsure where to start, and it's hard to read, and he only has the King James, and he gets lost in the language, and he's got all these struggles ahead of him if he really wants to dive into God's Word. But he must want to. There must be some part of him that's aching for God because he's soliciting information and advice, comfort, encouragement from Dustin. Right? And Dustin talks to him about there are other translations. Clint did not even know that. And he tells him about some of the Bibles we have and how much easier it is to read when you read it in not King James and all of this. And he's talking to him, and I'm so proud, first, that the guy asked Dustin about it. Secondly, that Dustin talked to him about that there are different translations and how he might get a copy and that we might want to buy him a copy if he needed one and all that. But how much better if, because of intense Bible study, Dustin hears his story, and immediately a story from the scriptures clicks in his mind, and he says, let me share a story from the scriptures with you. And maybe he tells the story of Moses, and not believing he could speak and lead God's people because he had this language problem, but then God says, I can do anything, and I will give you the words. Maybe he suddenly thought of the story of whoever in the scriptures, right? And he shares a story with them. And then maybe he relates his own, Dustin's own life story to this biblical story, and then says how that might impact Clint's life and his life story. This is why it's so important for us to be biblically literate, so that on the turn of a dime, somebody is in need of a word, we have a word to give them. We know the stories. We know the characters. We know the plot. I heard a song this week that I'd never heard before. It's a hymn, and it's all about the Bible. It's called Ancient Words. Have you heard this, Miss Carol? It's a beautiful song. It says, holy words long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Let them give us strength. Let them help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, may God's ancient words guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me, changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart holy words of our faith, handed down to this age. Words that came to us through sacrifice. Oh, let us heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words long preserved for our walk in this world. Which is really nice. And though these words and these scriptures that we're going to read together in this coming few months, though they are ancient and they are long preserved, they are still relevant for how we are to live our lives, how we are to treat ourselves, treat one another, how we are to worship God, how we are to help God build his kingdom, how we are to do so many things are so relevant. Hopefully this Bible study that we're about to embark upon together will help us to gain a deeper sense of the Bible's relevancy for our daily lives and help us to help other people with that knowledge. So today, I want to ask you to covenant with me that we're going to study God's Word together. Will you make that covenant with me? Yeah? Yeah. I want us to covenant together to ask God to bless us as we study. When you open the scriptures, whether you're reading straight from the story or you're supplementing it with some other Bible that you also have, whether you're reading articles online to supplement your study, when you open your scriptures, I want you to covenant with me that you're going to ask God to bless you as you read and as you study. Can we covenant together? because the Word is a living Word. And always, but especially if we ask God to bless us and to move by His Spirit as we read His Word, things will jump out at us that we have never thought about before, never heard before. Stories we need to hear right where we are that day. It's a living Word. I also want us to covenant together to seek the movement of God's Spirit, for it to come alive for us. Can we covenant together to do that? And I want us to have an awesome time. To covenant that we're going to enjoy reading God's Word, enjoy talking to one another about God's Word, talking about it in Sunday school, talking about it in our small groups, talking about it when we have lunch or have people over. I want us to covenant to have a good time studying God's Word. Amen? So get your copy. If you want a copy that's here, please take one. If you want to come get one, I think probably $5, $7, $10 will cover whatever she spent on getting them here and the shipping. And we'll get started on October 3rd. Let's pray together. Gracious Lord, as we prepare our hearts as a church, as your people, to study your word together, bless us. Lord, as we prepare in the coming weeks to get our books and to get our side books and to get our all of our stuff together, to get our candles or whatever, however we're going to set up our space where we're going to read and encounter you in your word, bless us. For those who are going to lead Sunday school discussions, bless us. For I am going to preach most of these sermons, bless me, Lord. Bless us, bless us, bless us. As we seek after you, seek to know you better, as we seek to be more filled with more of you, so we can pour that out into the world and the people around us. Lord God, we ask all these things in this mighty, precious, holy name of your Son, Jesus our Savior, who died for us so that we might have life. Lord God, we love you, we thank you, we praise you. We ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen. Our closing hymn is "May You Run and Not Be Weary." Ambassador in the world to love other people. Go filled with the Spirit. Go in His name.